No, Dr. Lee, when do you want?
Okay. Yeah, okay. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. Okay, I'll give a quick talk about the effect of the non-drug interventions for containing the COVID-19 outbreak in China. I'm from the University of Southampton. My research group, WorldPop, we are a research group to produce the spatial and temporal demographic maps to support the socioeconomic development and also the disease surveillance. I used to be an epidemiologist in China CDC, and I also graduated from medical school in Wuhan. So at the early stage of this outbreak, I already involved with my colleague in China to support them to understand the spread risk of this virus, and also how can we contain this outbreak. And we have already have some reports published in the WorldPop website. If you have interested in it, you can have a look. And I think many people already know that the number of cases in China already decreased dramatically in China. And the implementation of these interventions coincided with the rapid decline in the case number across China. But a comprehensive and a quantitative comparison of the effectiveness of different intervention in China and their timings for outbreak control is lacking. So for my study, I try to look at what the different effect impacts of these various interventions. New emerging disease, effective drug and vaccines are not expected to be available for next couple of months, as I think we know. And healthcare resources will be very limited for treating all the infections. So the non-pharmaceutical interventions are therefore the essential components of the public health responses to this outbreak. And in China, these measures, including like social distancing measures and travel related measures, such as the ban and the lockdown of Wuhan, and also the travel restrictions across China. And the third one was the case, early case finding and contact screen and isolation. And also the population and the personal protection and environmental measures all together try to interrupt the transmission of the COVID-19. And in this study, we looked at three groups of the interventions. The first one we looked at is the intercity travel bans and restrictions. Here we use the historical and near real-time the population movement data we have obtained from an IT company called Baidu. It's similar as Google. Okay, and we use the city level data set to look at what's the change of the population movement pattern during the outbreak. And the second group of the intervention is the inner cities contact reduction and social distancing. And this also derived from the Baidu data, mobile phone based population movement data. But we look at much more detailed spatial scales and to use the indicator derived from the mobile phone data to as a proceed of the social distancing measures. And the third one is the early case identification and isolation. And we use the delayed from the illness onset to the reporting into this information system in China CDC. And we look at if the, we assumed if the delayed is shortened, it means the cases have been identified earlier and isolated earlier. Okay. And here we use a SEIR model to try to reconstruct the transmission, but we make some change to include the travel data into the SEIR model here. Here I have some results. It shows the movement patterns in this year in 2020, and also the and the population movement pattern in previous years. The blue one means the population movement pattern as usual, if doesn't have any travel restriction there. And the red one means the travel pattern under the outbreak. And you can say this is the relative travel pattern for each cities. Each line means each curve means each cities. And you can see that have a huge difference. And there are the number here, such as from the first day of Wuhan city's lockdown, the population movement volume, the number of the population movement out to Wuhan is still like 90% as usual as previous year, but then it's decreased dramatically for all the cities across China, from the 90% to the just the lowest to the 19% on the February 4th. And after the lifting of travel registration on the 17th of February, the population movement is going up and trying to back to the normal. And this one shows the cities in Hubei. And the dark blue and the dark red curves shows the Wuhan cities. And you can see that's the dramatic reductions of the population movement out from those cities during the outbreak until the February of 29. Based on these kinds of model, including the case data, the epidemiology parameter, and also the population movement data, we built an SEIR model and fit with the epidemic curve here. And the blue curve is the estimates from our model, and it shows the median and interquartile range of our estimates. And the red curve means the reported data is the reported at curve, and our estimate looks quite it fit well with the reported data across the different regions for Wuhan, for other cities in Hubei province, and also other province in China. And we also look at the specificity and the sensitivity of our model to predict what the spatial distribution of the cases and the city level across China. And it looks like we have very high the sensitivity and good specificity to predict the distribution of the cases. So we based on these kinds of data, we test the different scenarios under different intervention and also timings. And it shows if without any intervention, without any improved non-pharmaceutical prevention intervention, the number of the cases will increase rapidly in China with 41-fold increase in Wuhan and 92-fold increase in other cities in Hubei province and more than 100-fold increase in other province as of February 29. And when we look at the effect of different intervention, we found without the intercity travel restriction, such as without the Wuhan city ban, the number of cases sounds not a huge increase or increase or decrease. I think it's because the travel ban in high cities is happened a little bit late before the huge number of people live in this city before the Chinese New Year. And the second intervention we look at is the intercity contact reduction, is the social distancing measures. If we allow the social distancing measures, the number of cases will increase around three-folders. And if without the early case finding, isolation, and testing the cases as soon as possible, and the number of cases will increase five-folder, it looks like the early case finding and isolation is one of the most important in the short term. But all the intervention together will have higher impact, and it looks like if without all three types of the intervention, the number of cases will increase dramatically. Here just show the curve if without any one kind of intervention. And this is one that if without the travel restriction, it shows the curve didn't change too much. And this one shows if without the early case isolation, the number of cases will increase dramatically. And this one is just without the social distancing one. And but in the long term, because this only shows like for next 3 months, 4 months, if without the in the long term, if without the social distancing measures, the number of cases will be increased exponentially. And here shows the timing of the intervention. And I think everyone knows early intervention, we have more get higher impact, prevent more cases. And it shows if we can conduct the intervention 1 week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks earlier in China, and we can prevent more than 60%, 80%, and 90% of cases, normal cases. And definitely, if we have late intervention and we have more cases. And this one also shows the spatial distribution of cases. The figure A shows the number of the distribution of city have reported cases as of February 29. And this is based on the reported data from the Ministry of Health. And the figure B on the right hand side, we shows the if we have 2 years, 2 weeks earlier intervention, and we will prevent lots of the cities has the cases. And it's only if we can prevent earlier than 2 weeks, and we have only 136 cities affected. And now China try to back to normal, try to lift in the travel registration. And it shows China lifting the travel restriction outside of Hubei province since February 17, and just two weeks ago, China lifting the travel restriction outside of Wuhan cities, and all the people in Wuhan they can, except Wuhan in Hubei province, except Wuhan city, they can travel, they can leave their cities. So you can see the people, the movement pattern to China, is getting back to the normal. And this one shows the cities in Hubei province. So except Wuhan cities, all other cities, the movement pattern is back to the normal, and also have more the people leave the cities to make to other province to get to back to their jobs. And that Wuhan still in the travel situation. And next week, the Wuhan city will be lifting the travel ban, and people can leave their city. But we are interested in what happened next if the after the lifting the travel restriction. And it looks like in our, based on our model, it looks like if doesn't have any social distance measures and just back the travel pattern, back the population contact pattern back to the 100% as normal, and it looks like the outbreak will be going up again. But try to make sure the fully control the outbreak and only need very small limit contact reduction, such as 25% contact reduction can prevent the resurge of this outbreak across the countries. Yeah. So here's just some quick summaries. One is the non-pharmaceutical interventions can prevent the outbreak and can contain the outbreak. And the effect of the different types of the intervention varied. And it looks like in the short term, the early 8 case detection and isolation have prevented more the infection. But also in the long term, the social distancing, it looks like it can also prevent a huge number of the infections. But combined interventions can achieve the strongest effect. And one more thing is the timing. Implementing the intervention as early as possible is the key. But I think never too late to implement the intervention. And social distancing interventions should be continued maybe the next couple of weeks in China to fully assure the contempt of this outbreak. But still have lots of many new challenges, such as now is increasing the imported cases from other countries into China. And the local cases now every day is just one of 5 cases found reported in China, but the imported cases is around 50 cases. So, and also have now more study I needed to look at the non-asymptomatic infection and subclinical infection. It's also another source of the infection, and maybe can cause another wave of this outbreak. But I would like to stop here and take any questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lai. I have two questions for you. First question, according to the Chinese figures, when the isolation measure can be lifted?
Sorry?
According to Chinese figures, when the isolation measures can be lifted?
The measure they can be lifted is I think it's the 8th of the April, as I know. Yeah, they try to lift the 8th of April. But I'm not sure. I think in Wuhan and in Hubei province, they maybe take a longer time to implement of the interventions to look at to make sure they fully contain this outbreak in the epicenters. Okay.
Last question, Dr. Ling. What do you think about the use of masks to prevent the spreading of COVID, the mask in the community?
I know there have many discussions on this in different countries, including in UK and in the US. But from my view, and also from the I discussed with my colleague in China, I think it's very important to take the next the maskers in the public, especially if you want to stay in the very small space with many people there, such as the public bus, such as the subways. Yeah, I think it's very important to wear a mask. And you know when the government talk with keep 2 meters distance, it means sometimes you cannot keep this distance, it means it's better for you to wear a mask, right?
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Lei, for the interesting presentation.